Hello everyone, greetings of the day. In a previous class, I started with a poem, No Men Are Foreign, which is written by a great writer named James Kirkup. As I told you, he is not just a poet, he is a fiction writer as well as he also did journalism. He lived till the age of 91 years and passed away in 2009. And through this poem, he is trying to convey a message of brotherhood among everyone, and he says that the whole earth is one. We should not look at the barriers, but because it is divided into countries, but all that the poet wishes to say here is that the whole earth is one and all the human beings are just same. That's the reason he has titled the poem as No Men Are Foreign, and he begins the first line of the poem by saying, no country is foreign and no men are strange. So countries are not external, everything belongs to the same earth and men are not alien. When he said foreign here, he meant that people are not belonging to some other planet. All humans are same, they should be treated equally. He has also told through the first three stanzas that the war whenever happens, lot of bloodshed happens because of that. People lose their lives during war. People also spend days without food due to starvation, as food becomes unavailable during war as it does not reach people at the correct time. So today, for the last two stanzas, we will see how the poet concludes this poem, and then we will also look at the literary or poetic devices for this particular poem. Before going to the last two stanzas, I would read the entire poem and then we'll go on with the discussion of these lines and its vocabulary. No Men Are Foreign by James Kirkup. Remember, no men are strange, no countries foreign. Beneath all uniforms, a single body breathes like ours. The land our brothers walk upon is earth like this, in which we all shall lie. They, too, aware of sun, air and water, are fed by peaceful harvests, by war's long winter starved. Their hands are ours, and in their lines we read a labor not different from our own. Remember, they have eyes like ours that wake or sleep, and strength that can be won by love. In every land is common life that all can recognize and understand. Let us remember, whenever we are told to hate our brothers, it is ourselves that we shall dispossess, betray, condemn. Remember, we who take arms against each other, it is human earth that we defile. Our hells of fire and dust outrage the innocence of air that is everywhere our own. Remember, no men are foreign and no countries strange. I put up the last two stanzas here. Like he said in the previous stanzas, that the earth is same, human beings are same, the natural resources which is available treats everyone equally. Then why this inequality that people show towards each other in this planet? He says, when we live, the land treats us equally. When we die, we are going to permanently be lying in the earth. So, as humans, when we live, we need to remember that we should come out of war and we can gain confidence and strength of each other by love and peace. So here he says, once again he stresses that we have to remember. Yesterday I told you that the repetition used in this poem is the word remember. From the first three stanzas, we saw that remember word has been repeated multiple times. So here once again he tells us to remember that when we are told to hate our brothers. So brothers, like I told you in the previous class, that brothers are fellow human beings who live with us in this earth. So when we are told to hate our brothers, who tells us to hate someone? Is it our family members or neighbors? The countries, the governments of the countries, for whichever reason they decide to take war against another country, is the time when even a common man gets into his mind that, oh, that country is not good. We start hating the people of that particular country. So the poet beautifully tells us that, remember, when we are told to hate our brothers, it is ourselves that we shall dispossess. So what does he say? We are going to shame ourselves. We are going to be away from our own selves. When we are hating our own brothers, we are as good as hating ourselves. In the sense, humankind cannot hate humankind. One person should not hate another person. That's what he says. When you are told to hate someone, you are dislodging yourself. Betray and condemn. Betray means cheat. Whom are you cheating? You are cheating yourselves. So, when you are told to hate someone, it is ultimately yourself that you are hating. Condemn means to criticize. So, when you are told to hate someone, you are criticizing yourself. You are speaking against yourself. When you are speaking ill of someone else, it is your own self that you wish to criticize. So, he gives a strong message that hatred should not be taken up. It is the brotherhood, love and affection that should be the ultimate aim in every human's mind. Once again he tells, remember, we who take arms against each other. Arms means the weapon, the hatred. Each other means country to country. Whenever we take arms, weaponry to fight during the war. So what he says, remember, we who take arms against each other, it is the human earth we defile. So the stanza 4 continues to stanza 5 with these two lines. You can see that there is no full stop or any comma. There is no punctuation mark used in this line. I'll ask you about this literary device later on. So he says, remember, we who take arms against each other, it is the human earth we defile. So what happens during war? Because of the bloodshed, lot of lives are lost. War happens in a border, which is away from the places. People are hardly recognized after they die in the war front. So what happens to the dead bodies? It is all spread like a clutter in the war field. So what happens? It is the human earth we defile. Defile means pollute. So what happens when lot of blood is shed on the earth? Many corpses lie down just like that in the war field. We are ultimately polluting the earth. So what happens? Our hells of fire and dust. What is this hells of fire? The war. The war includes a lot of fire and dust. Lot of smoke is involved in it. We not only pollute the earth, we are polluting the entire atmosphere, thereby polluting your own heart and soul. So he says, when, remember, we who take arms against each other, it is the human earth we pollute, defile. Our hells of fire and dust, the fire, smoke and dust that comes out of the war, as a result of the war, outrage the innocence. Outrage means it is beyond the innocence. This overpowers the innocence in a human being. It outrages the innocence of air. That is everywhere, our own. What is our own? The creation of this pollution. Pollution of the whole life system. Due to this war, what is polluted? Not just the earth, but the human beings are polluted from their mind and heart. And all this is as a result of the war which is created by us. That is the human. So earlier in one stanza he says that beneath every uniform, there lies a heart which breathes. So, every human being who stays in the war front fighting against each other has a beautiful heart inside. Instead of bringing that beautiful heart to each other, why to create this war and pollute the entire life system? So, he says, our hells of fire and dust outrage the innocence of air that is everywhere. Our own. What is our own? This miscreation is our own. Remember, no men are foreign and no countries strange. So in the first line he has told, no men are strange, no countries foreign. So here he said, no men are foreign and no countries strange. He has reversed the idea of men and countries being foreign and strange. So the first line is just reversed. So he says, men or countries, they are not alien, they are not foreign. So similarly here he has told, so men and countries all belong to the same community, the one community called earth. We live on this earth, we die and get buried permanently on this earth. So in between the process of life and death, why to get into war field and see bloodshed? So the strongest message conveyed by this poet through this poem is of brotherhood, peace and harmony. He says be one, live as one and enjoy the life given to us by this nature. Let's look at the poetic devices for this poem. Yesterday we saw that poet has used alliteration in some of the lines. In these two stanzas, it's for you to find out the alliterations and keep a note of it. We'll discuss it during the online class. And as I told you, the rhyming scheme of the poem is not present. So the poet has written this poem in free verse, wherein there is no rhyming word towards the end of these sentences. And the next device used by the poet is repetition. Like I told you, the word remember has been used several times by this poet in this particular poem. So he has again and again told the word remember to strongly emphasize that we are the ones responsible for whatever happens and we have to remember what should not be done and what should be done. So when we are talking about repetition and the word remember, if you count the number of times it has been repeated throughout the poem, I saw that it has been done 5 times. You can also count it and verify whether it has been repeated 5 times or more number of times. And then when we talk of repetition, I have also told you, it is not only the words which are repeated in the poem. There can be phrases also which are repeated. So if you look at the first sentence and the last sentence of the poem, you will know that he has used remember, no men are foreign, no men, no countries strange. So the lines are also repeated with a small reversal in the words. And then comes the technique, the literary device called enjambment. If you remember what enjambment is, it is the absence of punctuation towards the end of a line in a poem. In a verse, if the last word doesn't follow with a punctuation mark and then it is continued with the next line, we call it as enjambment. So you know it very well, children. You can just mark from the poem. For example, in stanza 4, first line and second line does not have any punctuation. So is the last line of 4th stanza. So line 1, 2 and 4 from stanza, enjambment has been used. Similarly, in the first 3 stanzas as well as the last one, you can find out in which lines the enjambment has been used. Just make a note of it in your textbook. And then we have the device called metaphor. So metaphor is the comparison of two things without the usage of words like or such as, without comparison words. So if we look at the poem, remember the initial stanzas, the word war was used to represent winter. So there the war is compared to the winter season wherein starvation happens because of absence of food. So in that particular stanza, war has been compared to winter. And then in the first stanza itself, he said that beneath the uniform, here the word uniform represents militaries or armies of different countries. So in these two places, he has used the literary device called metaphor, which compares one thing to another thing without the comparing words, comparing conjunctions called such as, like or such words. So that's all for this poem. If you are able to find some alliterations and other things which we might have possibly missed in this poem, you are free to text me. So we'll discuss this poem in the online class. Have a nice day. Thank you, children.